Thanks very much.
Fab. So today I'm going to be talking about service desk wellbeing and COVID and how we work together through the pandemic to really try and put a focus on wellbeing and to make sure that everybody had what they needed to do their work and look after themselves from a sort of work perspective. First of all, just wanted to say hi. What a pleasure it is to be here and doing this. This is a topic that's so close to my heart, and I really hope that you find some useful bits in here and that you can take away and implement with your own teams. I also wanted to say thank you to SDI for having me and everybody else for listening, and apologise for the technical blips as well. That was pretty much all on me. So just to start a bit about me, so I've been the service desk manager for 3.5 years at Manchester Met. That photo is from pre-pandemic. I don't know if you can tell with how close we all are. I have a personal interest in mental health. I'm an almost qualified counsellor. So in the next couple of weeks, I will be a qualified counsellor. I have a degree in psychology, and I also have personal lived experience of mental health issues. But most importantly, the second mention of cats today, I'm a very proud cat mum. So I wanted to give you a bit of background as to what we were like before COVID. I know that's been really useful when other people have done that today in their presentation. So we had 10 on the team, 7 analysts, 2 senior analysts and me. On average, we were getting 6,500 contacts per month. I did that the year before as an average. We did social activities once a month, and we were really close social team. I can imagine that everyone's service desk were lots of questions being asked in the office, lots of laughs and things like that. We did have working from home available, generally 1 to 2 days a month, but it did put us in a privileged position when we had to all work from home. It did mean that technically we did just go and work from home, and we were able to do that. Our services were exactly the same except from our face-to-face service. And just in a little overview of how those tickets came in to us. So we had the vast majority compared to the other channels was phone. So we got 57% of our tickets through phone, 39% through email, and face-to-face, live chat and portal about 2% each. And that's interesting because these are the changes that happened between March and September 2020. So we didn't have any change in service desk headcount, but we did have other people from other teams join us. So at one point we had about 15 people on the desk from campus teams, and it was a real sort of community effort and feel to get through the amount of tickets that we were getting, that huge rise in workload that we saw in March 2020. For those sort of 7 months, we got on average 8,500 contacts per month. In March and September, we got over 11,000 in those months. We were all working from home the entire time. Our workload changed pretty much instantly. And I've seen bits from other people about how live chat really blew up, and that's what happened for us. So we had our phone tickets reduce, our email tickets stayed scarily the same. Live chat and portal both increased by between 800 and 1,000% when March hit. Our call length increased by 300%. So on the phones, we went from a 3-minute average call time to 9 minutes. Our live chat was about 30 minutes, and the team can do 3 at once. So we're looking at about 10 minutes again for our average call length there. And that made a big difference on the workload, because it was 2,000 extra contacts per month on average, but actually when you took in the call time, it was probably like four times the workload that we were getting. And as you can imagine, and probably experienced with your own teams, we had burnout and isolation across the team. It was really, really difficult. I've just done a little workload comparison graph because I've sort of talked about quite a lot of numbers there. So this is pre-COVID, the COVID peak and the past year. I didn't really want to call that post-COVID. It didn't quite feel right. So I put the past year and hopefully soon we can have a time on a graph that says post-COVID. The main thing is that we saw a huge spike that has reduced, but overall we're still busier than we were pre-COVID. And that is in line with loads of things that everybody's all said this morning about the way that we're moving to more technology. You know, Teams is the infrastructure that a lot of teaching is being done, a lot of collaboration is being done. And that's sort of we're now in focus, like somebody else before said. I really liked that because of all the technology that people are using. So that was sort of all background. And now to talk about well-being. So the well-being of the team was my top priority, and it might seem a little controversial, but I put well-being above targets. I wanted to make sure that the team were supported. You know, they were supporting the university, and they needed that support too. You know, we were working from home, helping other people working from home, but figuring it out ourselves. So for the whole period, really, the last 18 months, we weren't talking about targets. We weren't talking about you know, performance or anything like that. It's individually, what we were talking about was how people were doing and what strategies they had in place and how their home environment was and, you know, how they were getting on generally. And that I felt was more important because I know that the team are always going to do their best, always. And that was never a concern, but I needed to make sure that they were well enough to support other people and that they weren't running on empty. So yeah, just wanted to make sure that they could manage their workload, you know, look after their own well-being and feel connected to each other and the university, which, you know, I'm sure everybody experienced. So what I've done is I've just put together some of the things that we did and continue to do on the next slides over the 18 months. I've categorized them into sort of like three categories. That it's loose, but hopefully it'll make sense. So the first thing I did was change one-to-ones to bi-weekly, so they were more regular. It was so apparent very quickly that I wasn't able to ask those questions in the office of how are you and really get a feel for how people were doing. It felt very isolating for me to not have that connection. So that was one of the first things that we did. We also created huddles for chats and catch-ups, and these were virtual, and the way that we did this was depending on what shift you were on, there was a designated time. There was three of them a week, so we essentially prioritized that time for a chat, half an hour, over you know, sort of them being available on the phones. So it's just a few people just having a normal chat, not work related. I'd drop in every now and again just to see how people were doing. But they were really, really helpful. They're one of the things that we don't have anymore because I'll talk about it later on, but we're working in a hybrid way now. So it's not necessary, but that those initial meetings were really, really useful. We also created wellbeing questionnaires, and these I've got a sort of screenshot of these on the next page if anyone's interested in the kind of questions that we were asking. But these were put together by senior analyst at the time in my team, who she created one, and then we basically asked the team to fill it in, went through it in the team meetings, and pulled out parts of it that we could discuss, change, have ideas about, and generally just get a feel for how everybody was doing. That, you know, in meetings it was difficult to talk virtually in regards to some of these things. So yeah, we did one a month after working from home, and we did another one 6 months later, and sort of collated all that data and chatted about it with the team. They were really, really helpful in learning about what people needed, what knowledge they needed, where they needed to find things, what that sort of operational need that they had was covered by the questionnaires. Development time slots. So we did have these in person, but we actually made them more regular because in the office you learn a lot from other people, and with that gone, that learning culture that I really, really want to promote had kind of gone with it. So we gave the team development slots for them to work on you know, anything they wanted to, really. We left it really open, you know, encouraged LinkedIn learning. Some of the team did some networks, some did bits on Azure, and just a bit of time to breathe as well, and continue to develop. We also put in open chat drop-in sessions. So these were on a Friday afternoon, and it was just a Teams chat that was open the whole afternoon for people to drop in, have a chat. You know, you'd stay in it when you can. If someone got a phone call, they'd leave it and come back. And again, it was just to really try and promote that office feel of, you know, I have a question, and just make people feel like more connected to the team and to me in an informal way. We also did an away day. It was virtual over Teams. It was in February of this year, and it was one of the most special things that we did in this whole time. I've put the agenda on another slide I'll show you in a minute or so, but I focused it completely on reflection. Usually with away days, I do a sort of morning on reflection and an afternoon on, you know, strategy and where we're going to go over the next year, but it wasn't what the team needed. The team needed to reflect and relax and have fun, put some sort of like, they put like a fun quiz in there about each other, and some mindfulness exercises as well, just to help people cope while they're on the phones, really quick things, and just get the team chatting again. And the feedback from that was really, really positive. So with this is the wellbeing questionnaire. It's not all of them, but just for any ideas, I know these slides will probably go out. So if anyone wants them, my email address is at the end and I can send them out as well. And the away day agenda. So lots of different activities where people chatted. And again, like I said, you know, grounding exercises and things like that, which I had learned from you know, my counselling experience, but actually were really simple and useful, and you know, anybody could do really. The next section was social. So these were all the social things that we put in to help people feel connected and feel like a team. It's so important that they felt like that, because that was and still is the foundation of the way that we work. If the team are together, then we'll do a really good job. You know, we'll, performance is exceptional anyway, but that is such a big part of them feeling happy in their roles and happy in their teams. And so yeah, we put quite a lot of effort into this, and that wasn't difficult because it was really fun. So The first thing was regular virtual games and quiz nights. So we basically replaced our social events for games and quiz nights, like for like. So probably at the beginning, probably more than once a month, but just a chance to get everybody together and have a chat and talk about how crazy the whole thing was, because at that point it was still just so bizarre, doing everything virtually. So it was nice to have that fun time with everybody. And there was really good attendance in those as well, which was really nice to see people in a more social way. These have, at the moment, we've had one social get together since we got back. We did it in the office, sort of just to make sure that everyone could chat and felt comfortable. But yeah, we're still sort of moving over to a more in-person social calendar. A book club. So I started a book club, which wasn't just for the service desk, but for anybody in the department that wanted to join. It was really successful. It's still continuing now, and it just was another sort of way of connecting people, and people that, you know, might not like usually attend a games night, but they were into reading and hear from different types of people. So yeah, that was really successful. We also did virtual Secret Santa and a Christmas jumper day. We saw a screenshot of a Christmas jumper day earlier, and we're going to see another one in a minute. But yeah, with the virtual Secret Santa, there was lots of tools now online to help you do it. And there was, I think, about 20 of us that took part, and everybody got their present in time for the Secret Santa uncovering, which was just amazing. So yeah, that was really good, really thoughtful presents, and things like that. We also did virtual goodbyes and leaving dues. So anytime, you know, somebody left, made sure that they still got a speech, they still got the presents, they still got the cards, they still, you know, got that goodbye from the team, even though we couldn't be there in person. You know, that was really important to make sure that we were able to do that. And this is probably one of my favourite things that we did. We utilised Teams for fun, because Teams is brilliant. We all use it all the time. But using it for fun really brought out lots of things that were missing from being in the office. So dad jokes, we have a resident dad joke teller, whose creativity needed a channel. So we created that. We made like a fun team channel for everybody. So I've got a screenshot of that in a moment. And a sort of email of the week, which was where in the office, sometimes you just say, can you believe this has just happened? Like, this is just ridiculous. And that sort of output wasn't available. So we made an email of the week channel where those types of things could be put in. And that is still going strong. We're working in a hybrid way, but it's still going strong. So here is our Christmas jumper day. This is as many of the team that I could get off the phones at once. So it's more than usual, but not everybody. And this is a collection of our utilising Teams for fun, which brought me so much joy to put this slide together. Things like, what do you call your evening meal? Is it dinner or is it tea? This sloth sort of like picture has been the sort of like an icon of the team over the 18 months. Lots of funny things, lots of dad jokes. This smells like team spirit is lots of different aspects to that people get involved in. So yeah, if you don't have something like this on Teams, I would highly recommend it. It's hilarious, and the team never cease to amaze me about how funny they are. They're just so funny. And then personal things. So I'm just going to quickly go over this, but I have been open and honest about my own mental health struggles. I got amazing feedback and support from the team that I understood their position and that they felt the same and that they were able to be open about their own issues. Active listening in one-to-ones, which is something that I've stolen directly from my counselling skills, but just to make sure that people, people felt listened to. You know, there wasn't just the pandemic at the time. There was lots of different socially difficult events that happened over the past 2 years, and it was important so that the team felt like they were being listened to, and that we were all going through the pandemic together. We all experienced the same struggles. You know, we were all in the same storm throughout that time, and that was really important to help us bond and feel like together, that togetherness. These are just a couple of things. So this is just an email that I sent, the beginning of an email sent to the team, and then actually a card that they wrote in, just to say how appreciative they were of being open about mental health on the team. Challenges. So I guess everybody felt these challenges. I couldn't change a pandemic. I couldn't change the team's home working environment. I found the transition to managing virtually very difficult. I'd only been a manager for a year and a half before this all happened. And I was very much a people in person. I'd just come to your desk, I'd run around. And that when that changed, that was hard. Defining processes as they were coming up. I don't know if anybody else got this, but as the team were on the phone, we were basically making up processes for things we'd never seen before. And the experts that the team were didn't feel like they were experts because it wasn't a familiar ground. So that was really difficult. And workload changes across the channels. So constantly moving and changing resource. We went from majority on the phones to majority on live chat to basically abandoning email being answered because there was too many of them. It was that kind of agility that was difficult. And actually now we've got a different model that works. So I've just run over time slightly. So just want to sum up. This is where we are now. We've actually grown over the past 18 months. The sort of increased workload meant that there was a business case for more people on the team. We do hybrid working, so we have average 2 days per week in the office, and it feels like a really good balance for most of the team. We have less phone calls and less emails than when we started, but more live chat and portal. Our call length is still 200% compared to pre-COVID. And most of the things that we have put in place are still there. And that's the end of my slideshow.
Hi, Kate.
Hello.
Thank you. Hi, thank you. That was a really kind of open, honest and passionate presentation. So really, thank you. Thank you very much for sharing that. It's brave to say I'm not okay, and it's much mm-hmm. easier just to pretend that everything is okay. So it's really, really brave. So thank you for sharing that with us. I know you're joining us. At the end, we've got another Q&A at the end of today's session. I know you're going to join us for that, which is fabulous. And I do just have a question from our audience, which is a kind of an organisational question, which one probably lots of organisations face, is when you're doing a away day, how do you do it so that everybody and the whole team can attend? How do you make that magic happen for everybody?
Yes, that's a good question. So we are sort of use Norman for out of hours. So Norman at Northumbria University, they essentially cover us in the evenings and weekends, and they were able to do us that for one day. I wrote a business case for it, and at the time, you know, it was basically just purely about mental health and how important that was. And was able to get that approved. So we did a lot of prep beforehand, let Norman know to cover that whole day, and we're really grateful that they were able to do that. With team meetings, we do things in two halves. So I appreciate that struggle of trying to get everybody in one place for a whole day. Yeah, it feels magical when you manage to do it.
Yeah, and do you think that's something you'll be able to kind of carry on? So in the future, will you do an away day with everybody? Will you get approval again, do you think, for Norman? I know I'm perhaps asking something you can't say, but, you know, do you think that'll be the norm going forward?
Yeah, I hope so, because it was so beneficial It really, really was. So for the cost benefits sort of realization, it is entirely worth it, I think. So yeah.
Fabulous, lovely. Well, thank you very much, Kate. Thank you for joining us. And as I say, we'll be chatting to you in a little bit later. We've got another panel debate which you're joining, which will be fabulous. So we'll say goodbye for now, and we will see you again very shortly. Thanks very much,
thank
Kate.
You. Thanks so much, Tessa.
Okay, so now we have our next presentation of the day, which is Runshaw College's VIP programme. So I'm delighted to be joined by Andrew Grant, who is Service Desk Team Leader, and Alex Harding, who is Head of IT Services, Print Shop and IT Facilities. And they're both from Runshaw College, and they're going to talk to us about the Runshaw VIP programme. I'm hoping that they're both there. Do we have Andrew and Alex? So they've gone a little bit quiet.
Andrew is just joining now.
Perfect, thank you, Holly. And as I say, while they're just joining, Kate will be joining again. We have a final